I hope I have sufficiently motivated the user of Adele, so I don't know. Just what I want to point out is that so far, regarding the Adeles and what we have done about them, we have basically done set theory, so not much structure. So now I want to discuss the additional structure which come to the Adele, which eventually make it possible to do analysis. So I will start now from by looking just at the Adeles, and later I will come back to make more precise what I discussed at the end of last talk. But so now I just start with A, so the ring of Adeles. So this is the following ring. So it's, let V of V, the set of classes of completions of Q. So this is, V is just the prime, the set of primes, and say a completion which is written of an infinity, which correspond at the real completion of Q. And so the ring of Adeles is the following restricted product over all places of the various completions. And so can be written R times the restricted products over all P's of the QP's. And so I write it R times AF, which are the finite Adeles. And AF, so this is the set of sequences of p-adic elements for p-varying, and what we require is that xp belong to the ring of p-adic integer zp for almost every p. So you see, this is completely analogous to what we introduced, but we define this for the general linear group. So the condition that we add is that instead of having just p-adic numbers, then here we add the condition that we had a sequence of matrices, and we were requesting that almost all of these matrices had p-adic integral coordinates. So A and AF, these are rings. So what other interesting set can we find into? So and we have embeddings of. So we have Q, which embeds into this ring of Adeles. Simply, if you take a rational element, then you send it to the constant sequence, and because Q has a finite denominator for almost every prime, XQ will be a p-adic integer. So we have this embedding, and before we have discussed also this embedding, which is the same, so the diagonal embedding, and so the constant embedding. And we can also see if we want the ring of Adeles inside, so at least the additive group of Adeles inside the of finite Adeles inside the additive group of Adeles by sending a sequence XP to the sequence of the XP at all, every prime, and then we put zero concerning the R factor. Okay. We may also embed, so for we may want to embed also the p-adic field, so Q, so we can write delta P to be the embedding of QP into either A or AF, which is you have a p-adic element and you send it to the sequence with xp prime equals zero if p prime is not p, and p. Okay. So you. Okay. Okay. So this ring. So one important feature is that this ring. So it's a product, or it's a so-called restricted product of topological rings. These are even topological fields, and even with metric. And so, okay, one may want to give to this ring also a topology which is somewhat related to the topologies of its factors. And so, you cannot, so it's not a good idea to give this ring just the product topology because it would not have very good properties, but instead one puts on it the adelic topology. Topology and a basis. So I will define the topology by defining the open set or a basis of open sets are of the form. So the shape. Yeah. So an open set or a basis. So you take an open set of the shape product of over all V of omega v with omega v in qv is open. And what we ask is that omega p is zp for almost every prime. So I remind you that in the p-adic topology, the ring of p-adic integer, it's both open and a closed subset of QP. So it's even an open and compact subset of QP. And so this, and likewise, you give the finite adels the same, the similar topology, and it makes AF a closed additive subgroup of A, and each QP become closed, also closed inside the full ring of adels. Okay, so a few things that one can say now that we have this topology. So then we have this subring of AF, which is just the full product of the ZP. And then this, when you restrict the adelic topology to this full product, then you just obtain the Tikhonov topology because all these factors are compact. And so this is an open compact subring of of AF, and it is maximal. In fact, it's the maximal, and maximal, it's the only one, in fact. So it's the maximal open compact subring of AF. And maybe some things which can be interesting. Do I say this now? What do I want to say? It's maximal. Yeah, and let's say. Maybe just to be more concrete about this basis, so a basis of neighborhoods of the identity element for the additive group structure, so of zero in AF, is given by the of open and in fact open and compact is given by it's a sort of abuse of notation. It's correct. So it's just this product nz for n an integer. So when you vary n, you take these things, and the more and more n is divisible, the smaller and smaller your neighborhood is. Various properties which are important for A is that, so if we look at Q, it's this property that Q embedded into A is a discrete subgroup. And the one reason is the following. So if you, is discrete, so if you intersect Q, so here my embedding is the delta that I mentioned here. So if you intersect Q with, so this open set. So what are you looking at? You are looking at rational number which which are p-adic integer at every prime, which means that a rational number which is everywhere a p-adic integer is an integer. And then this integer has to be between minus one-half and one-half, so you only have zero, so it's, you see, zero is isolated by this neighborhood, so then you get the discreteness. And so it's discrete, but it's not too small, nevertheless, because, so it's a sort of exercise, so if you look at this quotient of additive groups. So what you obtain is that this quotient is homeomorphic to R modulo Z. So it's an exercise. So in particular, this is this is infinite, but this is compact. Because this thing is compact, it means that M mod Q is also compact. On the other hand, yeah, just for the record, if you look at the embedding of Q into AF, then you can show that this Q embedded this way is dense. And again, this is a consequence from the Chinese remainder theorem, and say a description of this basis of open sets of neighborhoods of zero. So depending on whether you have the adels including the real number or not including them, you see that Q has very different behavior. So these are some of the basics. And now what I want to do is to construct a bit more complicated objects, and I want to come to GLN of A and to G of A for G group of an orthogonal group. So So if you have A, then you can consider the product AN with the Adelic product topology. And the topology, and you can prove a lot of these properties. If you adapt them, they remain true. So in particular, Qn into An is discrete because it's just because of the product situation and so on. And I want to play with this. And so, okay. So now what I consider is V. So I consider V an affine subvariety, an affine variety. An affine variety. So here, this is n-dimensional affine space over Q. Okay. And so remind you, V, it's defined by an ideal of a polynomial, so, and it's a set of n uples such that which are cancelled by all the polynomials which are contained in some ideal defining the variety. In an ideal of polynomials. And so what you may want to consider is you have this ring, you have this this ring which is a Q algebra, and then you have this variety, so you may want to define V of A to be the set of X in now AN such that P of X equal 0 for all p in IV. Okay, and so here this is a ring and this is a polynomial whose coefficients are in Q, so they are in particular in A, so it's legitimate to compute this polynomial. And polynomial functions are continuous on the adels because the adels is a topological ring. So this, which is a subset of A to the N, is closed. Okay, it's a closed subset. And so then this variety as a closed subset of Rn inherit the Adelic topology. So, and you may have a concrete description, although the set may be empty, but nevertheless, you can write it as a set of XP with XP in V of QP and XP in V of ZP for almost every P. So it may well be the case that this set is empty, nevertheless. You may look at V of Q, and because of this discreteness, V of Q will be, if even so. Could be empty, but V of Q will be discrete as well. Will be discrete as well. Okay. So the most important example for us will be the case where V is the general linear group. So I remind you that the general linear group is an affine variety. So it it's a closed subvariety of the product of n times n matrices times the affine line. And the ideal defined I of GLn is the ideal generated by the polynomial determinant of Gij times t minus 1. So t is the coordinate of A1 and Gij are the coordinate of the matrix element. Okay, so if you take a matrix and you take a t and but you ask that this matrix time t minus 1 equals 0, it means that t times the determinant won't be 0, and in fact t will be an inverse of the determinant. So the GLn that you get in that way, which you see again as a closed subset of the of this product, so which is A isomorphic to AQ n squared plus 1, acquire the adelic topology and is locally compact. Yeah, maybe I did not say this, compact topological group. Okay, so yeah, I don't remember if I say this. So when you equip the adels with the adelic topology, the great feature that you get is that your topological ring is locally compact and separated. So it's very good properties. So locally compact, separated. Oh, I don't, maybe it's okay, it's being separated. I put it into a topological group, say. And so you can do now the same with any algebraic subgroup, so linear algebraic group, because you may see this group as a closed subvariety of this affine variety, and you give it with. So you consider G of A, so GLn of A, which is closed, so locally compact. Top. And just by, okay, so just an example, just to, if G is the special orthogonal group, it's ideal. So the ideal of G it's come from the equations so transpose of G time Q time G equals Q and determinant of G is 1. So here, Q is the matrix of the quadratic form into the, say, the canonical basis, and then you have this equation, which is a set of polynomial equation in the coordinate of G, and this is again a polynomial equation, so you have something which is closed. Okay. Any questions? So for people who are not used to this? No? Okay. So everybody is used to this? Yeah? Locally compact? It admits a basis of pre-compact neighborhood of the identity, say, because it's a group. So it contains very small compact subsets. So it's a sort of minimal thing that you want if you want to do reasonable topology. So so topology, I can understand at least. Okay. Okay, and so then you have the embedding, so g of q embeds into g of a, and it's discrete. On the other hand, if you look at g of q embedded into g of af, it's not so it's not necessarily dense. It could be quite big, but not maybe not dense. What are the interesting objects that you might want to see? So g of a, or let's say g of af, it's this restricted product. So I just repeat once again the definition. For any linear algebraic group. So yeah, I wrote this sometime. So g of zp, so which are the matrix with coordinates in zp, and maybe a more canonical way to write this g of zp is to write it as g of qp, as the stabilizer of the square lattice in g of qp, if you prefer. So you have this, and then you have inside this, you have g of z hat, which is just the product of the g of zp, which is an open compact subgroup. Not necessarily a maximal one, so you can find, if you are ready to change coordinates, you may adjust the square lattice to have a maximal compact subgroup. But anyway, so just at least what you can say is that this GZP is a maximal open compact for. I need a condition. Okay, I will erase this, otherwise, because of the unipotence. So if the group is semi-simple. So what is interesting is that g of AF admits a basis of a neighborhood of the identity formed of open compact subgroups. So that's very useful to have a very, very small open subsets, which are in fact groups and which are moreover compact. These are the principal congruent subgroups. Which are, so let me call it Kf of n, so for n greater than 1, Kf of n is the product over Kp of n, with Kp of n is the set of Gp in, let's say, G of Zp, so integral matrices with Gp congruent to the identity mod n. Okay, so if n is invertible, the condition is void, so it will be g of zp, but if n is divisible by p, it says that gp is p-adically close to the identity element. And so when n becomes more and more divisible, you get a shrinking set of open compact subgroups. Okay, and then you can just translate this neighborhood, translate them to any point, so to have a nice neighborhood. Okay, so now so this is merely local information. So now I want to come into some important finiteness theorem, so due to Borel. And we will make the link very quickly. So for all Kf into G of AF, an open compact . So when we look at the quotient G of AF divided by G of Q and divided by this Kf, and so this quotient is finite, and its cardinality . So which I will write H G of Kf is the class number of this open compact subgroup. So I will come to what we have done earlier, but just a small remark. If you want to prove such a statement, it is sufficient to prove this statement for any open compact subgroup. So if known for one, this holds for all, because if you have two open compact subgroups Kf and K prime F, so the intersection, it will be an open compact subgroup, and because it is open and compact, it's contained into the intersection and of finite index in both of the big groups. So in a sense, to prove this theorem, you have a choice of the open compact subgroup. So it's just formal. Hein? Okay. So now, of course, you will have recognized something I have said earlier. So if G is the orthogonal group and Kf is G of L hat, so it's a product of the stabilizer of the LP for P lattice. In that case, the fact that this double quotient is finite, this is the Hermite-Minkowski theorem. Why? Because you have G, so the genus, I recall you, the genus of the lattice L, so this is the orbit of L under this action, and so it's naturally identified with the quotient by the stabilizer, the quotient of G of AF by the stabilizer of the lattice, which is G of L hat. And then, if you make a second quotient, so this, here you have the genus, here you have the set of genus classes, and you know that this is finite. So this theorem of Borel, it's a wide generalization of the Hermite-Minkowski theorem. But okay, we will I will give a proof of this theorem now in a special case. So, proof if so for G is SOQ, and so I'm asking Q is Q anisotropic. So meaning that Q of X is not zero for all X in Qn minus zero. So the quadratic form never vanish on a non-trivial rational vector. Okay. And so for this, just I will just recall something. So I introduce, the Hadels, it's tightly linked with the notion of lattice. So I will translate this statement into some concrete statement about lattice for which we prove the theorem and even something stronger. So let me introduce L of Rn to be the set of lattices in lattices in Rn, so not necessarily rational rational basis, real so the Z module generated by a real basis of Rn. And okay, so let me take so okay. So as I said, to prove the Borel theorem, it is sufficient to do it for any open compact subgroup. So I will take an open compact subgroup of that shape. So I take L rational lattice, okay, and I consider the following map. So from the Hadels into the real lattices, okay, which let's say I have a needle element JR times GF, and I map it to the following. So I take GFL, so then I get a rational lattice, and now I act by my real element, let's say by minus one, something like this. Okay, and what do I get in under this map? So so this map, okay, so what do I get here? So the image is the union of lattices, of real lattices, which are in the GR orbit for the natural action, so GLNR acts on the real lattices, and so in the GR which are in the GR orbit of some lattice in of some lattice in the genus. Okay. And really you have identified okay, so you have this map, and this map, of course, it's not injective because you can see that. Okay, you can see that the group of rational elements, if you define this map that way, the GQ acts so maps does not do anything. So what this map gives you, it's an identification between the quotient JA modulo JQ modulo J of L hat, and it gets identified with this set of lattices. And but this thing, or you could do it directly also, it will be identified with the disjoint union of J, JR modulo gamma I. Okay, where, okay, let's say that so let me select a set of representatives of the genus classes. Okay. Okay. So I take a set of representatives of these genus classes, and even I don't even know that the genus classes is finite. It's just a set of representatives. And so what is gamma I? I don't want to make a mistake. So it's GQ intersected with GF I KF GF I minus 1. Where GF I is such that it sends L to the lattice Li. So. Okay, and so you can check, it's a set theory, you can check that you have this identification, and this identification, it's an homeomorphism. So this is a discrete subgroup of GR, so this has a topology, and you take this disjoint union inside, so to speak, inside the set of all lattices, and you get this. So this is completely general, but now I am going to use my hypothesis. So up to scaling Q, we may assume that Q of L, the lattice, so the quadratic form is integral on L. And so now, so for any x in L not zero, this implies that Q of x in absolute value is greater than one because it's a non-zero integer. Okay. But so you can see that if this property is true, it remains true for any, so then it implies that this is true. So Q of L prime is integral for all L prime in the genus of L, because if you want to check that something is integral, you need only to check it for every p-adic element. So for any prime number, and then the lattice L prime, you cannot distinguish much from the lattice L because they differ from each other by an orthogonal transformation. So you have this property, and so for any x in L prime and not zero, you have that Q of x is greater than one. And but then, if you just you apply also a real orthogonal transformation, you have that for all x in L prime prime in GA of L.
Where GA of L is just this map that I have written there. You have x not 0. So you have that Q of x is greater than 1. So, because all these lattices are isometric to each other. Okay, and this is very good because what it says, because Q it's a quadratic form, so this implies that for all x in L prime prime different from zero, then the Euclidean norm of x, if this is big, the Euclidean norm of x has to be big by some constant, which depend only on the lattice L, and not on L prime. Okay. So, the second thing that that you should know is that you may look at the volume, so the Euclidean volume of the lattice L prime, so which is rather the covolume, so the volume of Rn modulo L prime prime. And what you can prove or check is that this volume is in fact equal to the volume of the original lattice. So the volume is fixed. So now what you have is that you have a set of lattices, all of the same volume, which have no small vectors. So now you have Mahler compactness criterion. Implies, so you have to show that this set is closed, but Mahler compactness criterion implies that which is a standard result in the geometry of numbers, implies that the set is finite. GA of L is compact. So not only it shows that this quotient is compact, but also that this union is finite. So you get both in one strike. Some questions? So this is very basic, the simplest case of proof of Borel theorem, but it's...
So how general is the use of Mahler compactness? So for which groups would it apply?
So any anisotropic group, you do exactly the same thing. So the torus, so you get the finiteness of the class number of a number field.
And for symplectic groups?
No, I'm not sure. No. But okay, it's okay. I don't know the proof of Borel. So you can, if you want to have the proof of Borel finiteness theorem, it suffices to ask because it's published at IHES. So propriété de finitude. So you can even bring it back with you in the plane. I don't remember the volume, but I ordered it so for myself. So then you see that so at least you see that if Q is a Q anisotropic, this Adélie quotient, so GA modulo GQ modulo GL hat, it's a very nice space because it's a compact space. Even you can remove this quotient because then this thing will be compact because you quotient by a compact. But this set, it has a very concrete interpretation. It's a finite union of quotients of a real group by discrete subgroup.
And I remind you, this is basically the space we wanted to study, or we found when we were looking for the distribution property of representation of an integer by a quadratic form. So I remind you the drawing. So okay. Maybe I will put need some. Yeah, okay. It's not exactly. But so what did we add? On what side, if we think classically, we had here a collection. So we had made some gymnastics, and what we have reached, it's a collection of H X naught orbits. So okay, and what is okay? We had this orbit since it was G X. So for some representation, G X I is a real matrix here, defined by GXI of X naught equals XI over square root of D. So our problem about equidistributing the representation was about looking at a set of HX naught orbits into this union. And on the other side, we had to look, so this thing was essentially, so it's not exactly true because maybe it's, okay, you have this map, and it's not exactly an identification, so it's more an inclusion. And here, on that side, you have, you take the and I want to be correct, G. Okay, GR of GF prime, and we have this. And what are these GR and GR prime? Okay, so GR is a real matrix defined by GR of X naught equals XQ over D to the 1/2. And GF prime, it was a finite adelic element, a finite adel, such that G prime F of L equals L prime. Okay, and in so it's not always the case that this quotient, which you project into this quotient, correspond to doing this, but it's a subset of this quotient in general, and under some condition, it can even be the full set of representation that you want to have. So, and just I remind you the notation. So you have this G, it was SOQ, then you had produced out of the Hasse principle representation of D by Q in some lattice L prime. And and we have this subgroup of G, which was the stabilizer of XQ into G. And so you can do exactly what we did. Here we have this quotient, and we look at this an orbit into this big of this subgroup into this big quotient. Okay, and so what do we want to do?
What's X naught?
Okay, X naught. In the very beginning, we had this ellipsoid. I remind you, we have RQD of R plus or minus 1, of Rn, so it was a unit sphere or unit hyperboloid, and this if you pick x naught into this hyperboloid, then you get an identification. So this is a homogeneous space under Gr, so you may identify it with Gr with Hx naught with, so Hx naught of R, which is, okay. Okay, I wrote where X naught, so okay, X naught was this, yeah. Maybe I should write X naught. Yeah, just to be consistent. So maybe I switch a bit the notation from previous talk. But okay, so you make a choice just to identify this hyperboloid with an homogeneous with a quotient. So it's just an arbitrary choice, and it's a reference point, so to speak. Okay. So and. Okay, what are we going to prove in the end? So to prove the equidistribution statement. Okay. So GA and HA are locally compact topological groups. So they admit say left invariant R measure. So let's call it mu G. And because G GQ is a discrete subgroup, then you obtain by taking the quotient with the counting measure, then you get a measure which I will call I will call it mu g between brackets on that quotient. And in fact, in our case, and then you have mu h on g a mod h a mod HQ. Okay, so let's again assume that Q is anisotropic. So so what I will say is basically true, but it becomes a bit simpler in that case. So you have these two measures, and so there is a, okay, because these spaces are compact, these measures, so mu G and mu H are finite. Again, because you have a finite. In fact, the measure mu g, they are also right invariant from general things. So it's not true for a general linear algebraic group, but the left invariant R measure is also right invariant. But in that case, the groups are. It's true. So R. Right. G A. Invariant and a finite measure. Okay, and so you can normalize to be of volume one. So we normalize to have mass one. So the measure of the total space is one, which is always possible. And so what do we want to do? We want to prove that for any phi, which is a continuous function on, say, GA mod GQ. And what do we want? We want this continuous function, in fact, to be a continuous function on the quotient by this. So we will ask it to be g of L hat invariant.
Okay? Because this is a compact group, this subspace is a closed subspace of the full space. So.
Okay, just almost, I just write the statement I want to have. So I have this, and what I want to prove is that I consider the integral of phi of h d mu of h. And so what I need to prove at the end is that this integral converges to the integral so as d goes to infinity, and I remind you, there are some additional possible conditions. Okay. And so what happens is that it's possible here to take our functions phi to be of a very special shape. So this will be, so this function here that I am considering, so you can see these are continuous functions on this union of quotient. So these are perfectly non-exotic objects, I would say, and these are automorphic forms. Okay. And so what I will explain or describe next time is the necessary background to understand this statement.
Thank you again.